work that we do now, the physical work, is harder too, and also the responsibility of, you know, a production like this. Okay, we're not
going to pass each other. May we get your full name for the record?
My full name is Albert Michael O'Brien, but I'm known as Michael O'Brien. I tried to sue my parents for the first name, but it stuck. Michael O'Brien.
And where are you from, sir?
I'm from the Gold Coast in Australia.
And are you at the moment en route to someplace else?
I'm actually going through to Europe to see my family.
And at my request, were you... did you stop off in Los Angeles so that we might have an opportunity to take your deposition?
Yes, it seemed to be not inconvenient to do it that way.
What is your present business or occupation?
Well, I've just, in fact, tendered my retirement intentions to the Queensland Department of Education. For the last 5.5 years, I've been running the state primary media production facility for the Queensland State Government for audiovisual materials for school children.
Is that what you've done most of your life?
No, not really. I've been a teacher, I've been a lecturer, I've been a consultant, I've been a property developer. I've specialized in system designs for state media production facilities, and that's been my main management and design interest.
What is the extent of your formal education?
I'm a scholarship or a bursary graduate to university. I have a primary degree, a BA honours in English literature and language from the University of Nottingham, completed in 1961. I have a postgraduate diploma in education from the University of London, which was a bursary award at the University College of the Rhodesia and Nyasaland, as it was then, that is now in Zimbabwe, with double distinction. And I have a Master in Education from the University of Massey that was completed between the years 1971 and 1975.
In 1983, where were you living?
In 1983, I was living in Surfers Paradise on the Gold Coast in Queensland, Australia.
And at that time, what was your business or profession?
At that time, I was an owner of what we call management rights in Australia, which is the management and administration of a high-rise building on a unique entitlement basis. I was also a major investor in an outfit called Ingot, which was a development group, and we were into property development, and at the same time I was working with what we call site consolidation for high-rise or condominium development on the Gold Coast, with a specific focus of retirement village development, because of the nature of A, our population on the Gold Coast, and B, the need to put in place proper retirement villages, actually very much modeled on American stylistics.
Were you as far as the development is concerned in 1983, seeking outside sources of funds?
Yes, we were. I actually became involved with a gentleman called John Dole, who was a very high-flying accountant who had retired from Sydney. And he asked me to become his associate in the retirement village context. He used me to acquire sites and articulate the potential of those sites. That's dealing with councils and developing submissions and feasibilities. He was the number cruncher. And it became quickly evident that to develop these things effectively, we had to find a better source of funding than was immediately available from either joint venture partners, with some of the complications shed if one has independent finance, and our local banking. And to that end, we went offshore.
And did you look at all for Philippine sources of funding?
We didn't seek Philippine sources of funding initially. We were in Singapore and Hong Kong and Europe. But it consequently emerged that offers of such finance, not in US dollar terms, but in commodity terms, then were offered out of the Philippines.
And were you contacted by somebody, or did you contact somebody in concerning the raising of funds by using commodities as distinguished from cash?
What actually occurred is a gentleman called Andrew Tan surfaced in Hong Kong and was initially involved in US dollar money offers. Nothing eventuated because of collateral problems in Europe across some of the offerings, but he resurfaced with an offer of commodity in early in 1983.
And did you meet with him?
Yes.
Who else met with him?
John Edward Dole, Bruce Allen Tanner, a gentleman called Tuckerman, and myself on several occasions.
And what was Mr. Tan a Philippine citizen?
No, Mr. Tan was a Malaysian resident, according to the identification he furnished us with. He happened to have a Malaysian passport. He had a letter of introduction from the then Premier of Queensland, Sir Joe Bielke-Peterson.
Queensland's one of your states?
Yes, Queensland is a state in Australia, much the same as you have California and other states here. And he had a letter of introduction from one of the ministers of the federal government.
Did he approach you about using some commodity as a source of funds for financing your project?
Yes, he did.
Where did you meet with him?
We met with him in the offices of D.M. Clark Accountants, which was the business name of John Edward Dole's accountancy firm.
In Australia?
In Australia, yes.
And were there discussions concerning how commodities might be used to raise the monies that you wanted to borrow?
Yes, he was quite detailed in terms of how that could occur. We'd never, of course, contemplated commodities opposed to dollar transactions, because the most usual is the US dollar transaction for us, or Swiss francs. But he offered the commodity and gave us quite clear directions with regards to how it could occur.
Can you, in summary, tell us what commodity was the subject of your discussion and how that commodity might be used to serve your financial purposes of raising cash?
I'll try to do that if there are any questions, because it's fairly complex, but if there are any questions, then I'll
make
try.
It as simple as you can.
All right. He suggested that there was available ex-Hong Kong and other parts of the world.
That's an expression that's not necessarily used here. What do you mean, ex-Hong Kong?
From the port of Hong Kong. Its source could have been Hong Kong, but there were other universal areas of accessibility to this product, and the product was quite clearly identified as gold. We were told to proceed to Hong Kong and make contact with certain parties to discuss the volume that was put forward, and the initial volume, actually I remember quite clearly, was 5,250 metric tons of bullion. And I think our response would be the response of most people who has this sort of bullion. Nevertheless, Mr. Tan said, well, it is available. It cannot be sold in the usual fashion because of the source and ownership of the bullion. At which point in time we proceeded. Prior to our departure from Australia, the locus of the bullion or the commodity was changed from Hong Kong to Manila. Mr. Dole therefore went to Manila and entered into negotiations with parties concerning that commodity.
And did Mr. Tan explain to you how you might participate in some transactions with gold and as a result of that participation raise the funds that you wanted
yes.
for development?
Yes, he did. The intention was that because of the, how he called, the irregularity of source, it was being offered at 4% below the second fix, the second London precious metals fix each week on a Friday. That 4% offered the opportunity to any broker to interface between the seller and other buyers. If one does one sums, 2% of volumes of gold with this sort of capacity of profit is the same as getting dollar transactions available to use as a funding source. So in other words, it's very much a middleman situation, but based upon a 4% discount across normal London fixed price.
And the price of gold is, at that time, was routinely set in the London gold market?
Yes, it was, and at the time it was running at about $418 to $422 an ounce.
Did you people set up any kind of special mechanism or company or organization to work in this transaction so that you could eventually have access to monies to finance your project?
Yes, we did. John Dole, as I say, was an accountant. We'd already set up an organization through accountants in Brisbane, Henderson and Lay, an instrument to manage offshore funds. That instrument was based in the Bahamas. The name of the company was Remington. Its servicing company was a company called Groin, and it had service companies in Hong Kong, Bistray being one of those companies.
Was Remington an offshore corporation?
Remington was based in the Bahamas and therefore offshore, and therefore giving us tax minimization, as they call it in Australia, with regards to any fund management and disbursements to associates and participants.
Well, if the money that you made on contemplated gold transactions went to Remington, how is the money going to be made available to you for your projects?
It bounced out of the account in the Bahamas straight into the management company in Hong Kong, and from there instructions were quite clear with regards to how our accountants in Hong Kong would manage the matter. They would make available to us monies as loans. These monies as loans would come into Australia as loans, and therefore there would not be earnings, and therefore there'd be a tax minimization of same. We would then be unable to manage the rather large interest relating to those loans, and they're known as what are called collapsing loans. So that was the mechanism whereby you A, minimize tax, and B, access the money.
Had you ever dealt in gold transactions before?
No.
Did you address that issue with Mr. Tan as to why somebody who had no experience might be selected to handle gold commodities?
Yes, I did. My background taught me to be slightly skeptical. Even moderate academics are skeptical. And my question to him was, there are tried and true and hallowed methodologies for gold transactions which are shrouded in total confidentiality. Why would an outfit like Remington be offered the option of processing some of this material? And the answer was quite straightforward, and to my mind, made as much sense as anything makes sense in the world today, and that is that if one uses traditional methodologies, then the so-called confidentiality has become scuttlebutt. It's a scandal. It runs through the financial world. It's something you don't want if you're selling, unloading precious metals. The Russians had that when they sold 27 metric tons in Europe. You know, no one knew about the deal except that the price of gold collapsed as a consequence of someone learning. So the whole issue was to confidentialize the matter by using unknown parties, unheralded parties, and parties who also could provide a methodology that the traditional method of gold selling and movement did not offer.
Who gave you that explanation as to why you people happened to be approached rather than somebody in the traditional trading of gold?
Andrew Tan initially, and then the seller's representatives in Manila.
And did Mr. Tan, in this initial discussion with him before Mr. Dole went to Europe, identify the owner or seller of the gold?
He specifically intimated that the owner was a party in Asia of some large international standing.
Now, when did Mr. John Dole go to the Philippines?
John Dole left for the Philippines from Surfers Paradise, Brisbane, in May 1983.
And how long was he gone, sir?
He remained in the Philippines until late June 1983.
Did you have any communications with him during that period of time?
I had constant, daily, sometimes multiple contacts with him every day. From Australia via phone and telex.
And in general, what were the subject matter of those communications?
The subject matter was twofold. Initially, it was to do with the specifics, the mechanisms, and the viability of the contract details that were being offered by the seller to potential buyers, which was the initial part of the discussion, putting in place acceptable conditions within the contract. And secondly, I was the major interface with the buyers in the United States and Europe, potential buyers in the United States and Europe.
Did you, at the time you were approached by Mr. Tan, have any buyers that you were in contact with?
Yes, we did have, in fact, an enormous amount of interest, even at that point in time, before we'd finally specified amounts, availabilities. We had enormous interest out of the United States.
Was this before Mr. Tan approached you or afterwards?
No, this was after Mr. Tan approached, yes.
Was this before Mr. Dole went to the Philippines?
Yes, it was.
Were there any problems in your negotiations with the sellers concerning how this transaction was going to be handled so that the people who were buying could be assured that what they were getting and that if they paid money, they would get what they were bargaining for?
That actually was one of the major problems in all the contractual specification.
Did you work on that problem?
Yes, I did.
And what solution, if any, did you come up with?
Well, I came up with a question to a series of accountants who said things couldn't work the way they're being specified. The sellers wanted to put in place from the buyer an irreversible, divisible letter of credit. In other words, an unconditional cash instrument had to be offered by the buyer for a commodity, which in fact they wouldn't have for between 4 to 7 days.
Now, let me interrupt you there.
Yes.
Why wouldn't they be able to have the commodity for 4 to 7 days after they had paid for it?
Because one of the conditions of the seller's contract was that they wished to have the commodity re-assayed and re-smelted.
Now, what do you mean by re-assayed and re-smelted?
I mean that the product would be melted and refined and reassessed across Johnson Matthey levels of purity so that the buyer was to receive the 999 fineness specified in the contract.
Now, who at the time was Johnson Matthey?
Johnson Matthey are a universally standardized firm of commodity, precious metal smelting, and they are a benchmark in terms of purity of a product.
Were they located in 83?
In 1980, well, they're located in many places. Their primary smelting is in Europe, but they have sub-facilities in places like Singapore, I believe, in Hong Kong, and they even offer a mobile service.
You talked about 999 fineness. What does that mean?
It means that the gold is of near as damn it to perfectly pure.
All right, so there was going to be this 4 to 7 day hiatus, and was that a problem you addressed?
Yes, it was a problem, because if in fact the seller offering this slow service could not deliver the bullion for that period of time, then how would a buyer feel about having put up an irreversible letter of credit to cover the purchase of materials they weren't quite sure they were going to receive? So that no buyer would do that. if at the same time that's what the seller insisted upon, then by definition there could be no deal, because the contract could not occur. So we had to find a means of bringing into line an unconditional cash instrument and a guarantee that the product would be available so that the contract could occur.
Did you solve that problem?
Yes. We suggested that we have a conditional bank purchase order or a corporate guarantee put forward by the buyers, which at the point of time that the product is proven to be pure and of the volume specified, it immediately reverts to an unconditional cash instrument. So the buyer at that point in time is not at risk, and the seller at that point in time is not at risk, because both have been covered by guarantees and bank charters that the conditional instruments will do their job.
Did you work that out with any financial institution?
Yes, it was checked out by, its feasibility is quite straightforward in banking terms.
Was a bank selected to play that role in the deal once it was made?
Selected by whom?
I mean, by anybody.
Objective form of the question for hasn't established a foundation for this witness.
Go ahead and answer the question if you can.
Well, I don't really know that there's a problem in the question or in the objection, because in actual fact the bank selection occurs with both the buyer and the seller. The brokers don't determine the bank. The seller nominates his bank and the buyer nominates his or her bank.
And in these negotiations, did those nominations take place?
Yes, they did.
What banking institutions were involved for the buyers?
For the buyers, the major block came out of Mitsubishi,
where?
Wilshire Boulevard, Los Angeles, Trust Officer Stadnick, Walter Stadnick, Centera Bank, Mellon Bank, and two failed merchant banks, because you must use a prime bank to purchase commodity. But of the prime banks, Mitsubishi was the major player and the major guarantor of a cash instrument for purchase of bullion to the levels involved in these contracts.
And what was the seller's bank?
The seller's bank was nominated as the Hang Lung Bank in Hong Kong. Trust officer, Mr. Richard Yap.
Did you yourself have any dealings with Mr. Yap?
No, I did not.
Now, were written contracts entered into concerning the purchase and sale of this gold?
Yes.
Was Mr. Dole on the scene involved in the negotiation?
Mr. Dole's primary objective in the period May through June 1983 was to establish contracts to make possible these transactions. There were many contracts written which fell apart for various reasons, but nine contracts specifically signed by Remington occurred, and two further major contracts subsequent to the falling apart of the Remington situation after primary deliveries occurred.
So there were a total of 11 contracts?
At least 11 contracts that I can specifically and categorically say occurred and that I'm aware of, yes.
Now, what isn't clear to me is why couldn't this all be handled, the Remington contracts, as one contract? Why did you need nine?
Because we had different buyers. Or more specifically, we had different brokers introducing perhaps different buyers, but potentially they could have been the same buyers. They could have been individuals, they could have been government, they could have been corporations, they could have been Middle Eastern groups, they could have been anyone interested in bullion. But they reflect the brokers, and they don't reflect necessarily buyers.
The brokers were different, the buyers may or may not have been.
Correct.
Different.
Yes.
Now, did there come a time when you yourself journeyed to the Philippines?
Yes.
Approximately when did you go?
Specifically, I went on August the 17th, 1983.
And why did you go to the Philippines?
I went there because of two things. A, we were advised by American buyers that bullion transactions had occurred, but they had not received their brokerage. And there were related advices to me that if we didn't sort it out, then they'd do some terrible things to Remington, who somehow picked up the tab for contractual mismanagement. In fact, the banks are responsible for all disbursements, but somehow we became involved, or the source of aggravation in that regard.
Well, as far as the alleged statement that some portion of gold had been sold but hadn't been received, were these statements made by parties that were party to one or more of the contracts that Remington had?
Most clearly, two American gentlemen were quite specific about that. One was Joe Zabin, based, I believe, in Hawaii, and the other was Bill Kirby, based here in California.
And who was Joe Zabin?
Joe Zabin was a party introduced as a potential buyer to the commodity available by Mr. Milne Jurisic.
And who's Mr. Milne Jurisic?
He is a person who was practicing on the Sydney Futures Exchange in the early 80s. He has got quite advanced knowledge of bullion movements, processes, and selling mechanisms. And he attached himself to the Remington group by virtue of being a sort of consolidated broker for American brokers. In other words, he had knowledge of that network and was working to improve and diversify, for his own benefit, of course, the range of client group that we should have.
Who was Mr. Kirby?
Mr. Kirby was, as I understood from Mr. Kirby, a major American gold and precious metals broker, acting on behalf of very large clients.
Now, when you got to the Philippines, where in the Philippines did you go?
Went straight to Manila, but if I can backtrack, if you remember, I said there were two reasons that I went to the Philippines.
Oh, and I forgot to get the second reason.
And the second reason was because I received a telex from a man called Domingo Clemente, who was a signatory to all of the Remington contracts, saying, please come over and we shall satisfy the commission requirements of the first contract. So, on the one hand, we had the Americans complaining about lack of brokerage fees coming through, and on the other hand, we had our own concerns about the breakdown, potential breakdown of these contracts, and he offered to solve the problem. So that's why we went, and that's why I remember the date, the 17th, because it was some days after he sent his telex making that offer.
And did you meet with Mr. Clemente when you got to the Philippines?
Yes, I met with Mr. Clemente the day after I arrived in the Philippines.
Which was what day?
It was the 18th of August, and it was at the house of David Sayoc Jr.
Who at the time was David Sayoc Jr.?
He was the person who'd offered the use of his offices and office administrative machinery, telexes, telephones to John Doe during the period of time that the contracts were being determined and machined together.
Was he, to your knowledge, involved in any of the gold transactions directly?
Not directly. He was a major beneficiary as a consequence of his involvement in terms of making available these things, and he was involved and a beneficiary at John Dole's suggestion.
Did you then have a discussion about these problems with Mr. Clemente?
Yes.
And can you briefly tell us what those discussions were?
Yes. He said the problems that related to the staggering nature of the contracts lay in two quarters. One, the fact that Pedro Laurel was traveling and having difficulty in getting authorizations from Code 1 was a major problem. In other words, he was the senior partner and the senior signatory to all contracts and had full responsibility from issued downwards from Code 1.
Was Mr. Laurel, Pedro Laurel, a signatory of these 9 contracts?
No, Mr. Clemente was on his behalf, but Mr. Clemente had from Pedro Palafox Laurel an authorization to act in that particular capacity.
And in these conversations that you had with Mr. Clemente, he used the term Code 1?
He used several terms to indicate the source and responsibility. Code 1 was one, because if you look at the contractual situation, codes are used all the time, numerical codes, to reflect the alphabetical aspects of who is responsible. 1612, Pedro Palafox Laurel is one of the account codes on the materials that were signed. And Clemente used to use numerical codes too. So it was fairly normal for them to refer to the person who was the owner in code terms, and that was one of the terms.
Were codes used in these contracts to try to maintain confidentiality as far as who the sellers were?
Indeed, because like all numbered accounts, numbers mean nothing to those that cannot refer the numbers to the alphabet. Unless you're a cryptographer, then it's the whole basis of Swiss banking, that you have a numbered account. There are no names, no pactual, the numbers create confidentiality.
Was Code 1 ever identified to you?
Code 1 ceased to be Code 1 in the first discussion we had with Clemente, because the reason that he put forward for the cessation of the first contract was because of a usage letter of credit offered by Mitsubishi Bank, which meant that they received the product and on-sold the product, but they didn't pay for the product until such didn't want to pay for the product until such time as they'd on-sold all of the product.
What do you mean by on-sold?
Well, it means that if I can use you as Mitsubishi Bank as an example, you were the buyer and we'd gone in with our little codes and we'd agreed to purchase. You'd put forward your letter of credit that was conditional and should have become a cash instrument. What they tried to do was receive the gold, but you weren't the buyer actually. You'd become another seller and you were offloading it to your more valued clients at a special rate. Now, you didn't pay for your gold until you'd settled it all, which meant that you had your cake and you ate the cake. And he objected to that methodology, which is why he said he'd call a halt to the contract.
And how did he identify for you who Code 1 was?
My colleague, Mr. Jurisic, is 6'3", Montenegrin, and a very short fuse with regards to temper. Physically, he's very large. Mr. Clemente was built, I suppose, like a twig insect, dressed in denim. Mr. Jurisic could have snapped him into pieces with one hand. And Mr. Jurisic was inclined to move out of logic into physical activities very quickly. When he heard that Domingo Clemente had single-handedly called a halt to the first contract without reference to any of the major brokers, without any reference to any of the major banks, Mr. Jurisic went slightly crazy and said some fairly obscene things and made some fairly heavy suggestions to Clemente, like, I will drag you by the scruff of your neck in front of the president, and I hope he has you put against the wall and shot for economic sabotage. A minor sort of statement. And Mr. Clemente said, don't speak to me like that. He said, I am here because of the president. We are talking about the first family's commodity. We were talking about their confidentiality, so don't threaten me. You're in the Philippines, Mr. Jurisic. So the threat became nothing. He clearly identified at that point in time the owner.
Did you work out, at least for the moment, some solution to your problem?
Yes, we thought we did. It was to await the arrival of Pedro Palafox Laurel, who would then authorize disbursements on in the capacity of his signatory power.
Did Mr. Laurel ever arrive?
Mr. Laurel did not.
Incidentally, while you were there in the Philippines, we got in the record the date you got there. When did you leave?
I left on the 23rd of December.
Of what year?
1983. So I spent approximately 5 months.
And during that period of time, did you meet a fellow by the name of Norman Tony Dacus?
Oh, yes, I did. Yes.
And did you have some dealings with him over a period of time concerning this gold deal?
Yes.
Was he there representing any particular individual?
Yes, I gathered very clearly. He was there looking after the interests of Joe Zabin.
And Mr. Zabin was where? Do you know?
I was calling numbers in Hawaii and getting him quite regularly. Yes.
So you, during this period of time, had some communications with Joe Zabin?
Oh, yes. Yes.
All right. Well, what... did your problems ever get resolved so that these 9 contracts were fulfilled and you people got your money?
We never received any money. We never got satisfaction with regards to our activities. But we did receive other benefits, in inverted commas, for our troubles. I had Clemente and Laurel arrested.
And how did you go about that?
I sought assistance from the manager of the Holiday Inn, Mr. Michael Bischoff, and said, can you please introduce me to anyone who's high ranking with regards to political, economic, or legal representation in the Philippines. And he introduced us to Minister Enrile, Minister of National Defense.
Do you remember Mr. Enrile's first name?
Juan Ponce Enrile.
And did you meet with Enrile?
Yes, I did at Camp Aguinaldo.
And following that meeting, were either Laurel or Clemente apprehended?
Yes, Minister Enrile was sufficiently concerned about the authenticity of both our claims and the facts surrounding those claims as to immediately put Colonel Thelmo Cunanan in charge of the case, assisted legally by Major Billiones, who looked a bit like the Marx Brothers, you know, with a shock of hair. Anyway, they had in Camp Aguinaldo an outfit that specialized in tracking down people like this. And their first person was Mr. Clemente, whom they arrested very, very quickly after the events, and they interrogated him at Camp Aguinaldo. And
were you present for that interrogation?
Yes, I was, on at least 3 occasions.
And did Mr. Clemente make any statements in your presence concerning these gold deals or anything to do with the gold deals?
Yes, he went right back to what he said at the first meeting in the house of David Sayoc, saying that this was a matter that should not be misinterpreted by the military, that we were dealing with heavy-duty roles and responsibilities. His role was to make sure that this was expedited on behalf of the President of the Philippines, Code 1, that there any interference and static that was generated by activities and interference from the military and other parties would be very sadly viewed by the president, and again claiming that Mr. Laurel would solve the matter indisputably as and when he surfaced.
Was Mr. Laurel eventually apprehended?
Yes, he was.
Was he interrogated?
Yes, he was.
And where was he interrogated?
He was interrogated at Camp Aguinaldo.
And were you present during that interrogation?
Yes, I was.
Were any statements made by Mr. Laurel that related to these gold contracts?
Yes, he made similar statements to Mr. Clemente. And that was interesting to me because Mr. Laurel didn't know we had Mr. Clemente under arrest, and Mr. Clemente didn't know we had Mr. Laurel under arrest. So, yes, both parties made similar, in fact, identical claims with regards to who they were representing and what they were doing.
And did they mention representing anyone other than President Marcos?
Not at all. I can elaborate on that.
Let me ask you a question. Mm-hmm. Were any other members of the family included in any of these statements concerning their representation?
President Marcos was named specifically by Laurel and Clemente, but the first family was also a frequent reference, as was Code One a frequent reference.
And during the interrogation of, is that true as far as the interrogation of Clemente is concerned?
Yes.
Was that true as far as Laurel's interrogation
is
concerned? Who was it that was interrogating these people? Were the police, military, or what?
Military intelligence. Colonel Cunadan, as I understand, my microphone's falling off. As I understand, in relay situation at Camp Aguinaldo, Felmo Cunanan was in charge of military intelligence. I assume it's military intelligence too, because Master Sergeant Boy Passion had a whole range of agents who had code names like McLeod and Coburn and all these sort of American television show, and that's how they refer to their agents. I know it sounds fanciful, but I actually met with Coburn in a hospital clinic close to the Malate Cathedral. You know, Coburn. And I thought it was Disneyland. But that's the sort of intelligence grouping that there was there. And the interrogations occurred in the presence of and generally were led by Colonel Cunanan. But he was a fairly ineffectual person. Sergeant Passion, who I believe used to be an ex-heavyweight boxing champion of the Philippines, tended to take over. And when he weakens somewhat, my friend Mr. Jurisic did a fairly good imitation of an SS movie.
Okay. let me move on then. Did you, were your problems solved at that point or left unresolved after these interrogations?
No, they became curiouser and curiouser because Mr. Laurel was arrested at the house of a senator or an ex-senator known to be anti-Marcos, according to the information that I had, and having sympathies with the New People's Army. We actually pretended to be bullion buyers, assuming false identities, and arrived at the house of Senator Bienvenuda in one of the suburbs of Manila, and in tow we had Boy Passion, all the agents, myself, and we had very good witnesses from military intelligence. At that particular point in time, Mr. Laurel actually tabled a bearer certificate for gold, which Mr. Jurisic said was authentic, underwritten by Lincoln International, and he offered to sell us even more bullion if we could make with the cash instrument. All of that witnessed by the whole of military intelligence from Camp Aguinaldo.
Well, let me interrupt you there. Since your problems didn't get solved, did you attempt to get some satisfaction from the president himself?
Yes. I then said, well, you see, Cunanan and co. just disappeared. There were no phone calls. They'd arrested Laurel and Clemente, and we heard nothing more. It was the proverbial water poured into water. So where do you go from there?
And did you arrange for an appointment with the president?
Yes, I arranged.
Mm-hmm. When was that appointment?
It was earmarked for some time in October.
Of 1983?
Of 1983.
And did you or were you able to keep that appointment?
I was ready and willing every day for some weeks to attend. In fact, I sat on the edge of my bed on many a day in my slacks but no top, because it's very hot in the Philippines, ready to put on my crisp safari suit to meet the president, and nothing ever happened. But I had an actual appointment arranged by a Major William Cardenas. I know that it was received because I got a copy of that and receipted by the appointment secretary from Malacañang, and I even had a number issued in terms of that appointment, but I never had the appointment with the president.
While you were in Manila trying to solve your problems concerning the gold contracts, were you contacted by anyone else who wanted to get you involved in the brokerage of gold?
Yes, it was quite weird. After Laurel and Clemente were arrested and things just seemed to disappear in an Everest of candy floss and bureaucracy and total indifference, one night at about 11:30 I got a phone call from a guy called Ben Kailau, who said, I know everything that's happened to you since you arrived in the Philippines. And I said, I don't care anymore. I said, everybody knows what everything does in the Philippines. I said, you know, get out of my life, I'm going to leave the country, this is just bullshit. And he said, ah, Mr. O'Brien is not bullshit. He said, he knew everything that had happened in the interrogations. He knew everything that had happened with the interviews at Aguinaldo, with Bienvenuda. He knew everything that had happened with regards to the contracts, the specification of the contract. He knew everything. And he said, I even know that you've had death threats. I even know that you've been followed. I even know who follows you.
Had you at that point had some death threats?
Yes. Interesting ones. But he knew all of that, and therefore I said, well, come and let's talk. And he arrived and he had a file. And in the file, which is the only reason I didn't kick him out, in the file was a photocopy of my appointment with Marcos, duly endorsed by the appointment secretary. Now that I found very interesting, because even though I'd been told that I had an appointment, I'd never seen that. And he had that.
And did where were you when this meeting with Ben Kailau took place?
I was in my hotel room at the Holiday Inn.
Did he attempt to get you interested in a gold deal?
Oh, well, he was even more prepared than that. In the little file, he said, you just have a look at this file whilst I use the CR, which I think is a really cute descriptor of that, but that's where he went, the CR. And there in the file.
That's an expression we don't use. What's the
The comfort room.
He wanted to use the bathroom.
That's right, the comfort room. Yes. So he went there, and I read the file. The first document was the endorsed letter of appointment with Malacañang. The second document was a new contract. Fully prepared, with my name on the bottom. And it was in the name of Just Trade International, and it was for 225 metric tons. Very interesting, 225 metric tons. At a local gram cost for the bullion, local cost. And if you translate the local cost, you find that there's something like $60 an ounce profit in the cost across 225 metric tons. And what he said to me was, well, if you multiply this out, you will find that the benefits that accrue from this particular contract that I've been instructed by you know who to offer to you is about the same amount of money that's missing from your contract brokerage on the first contract that Mr. Laurel and Mr. Clemente have so sadly abused. They will be arrested, not arrested, they will be suitably disciplined by the president, probably shot, and this is his way of offering recompense to yourself and your organization for their failure to discharge this because they've been swindling.
Did you do any investigation at all to determine whether there really was any gold to sell?
Yes, I did. I said, Mr. Kyler, this is all very interesting and very, very Sherlock Holmes-ish, and I'm really impressed that you know all of this, but frankly, again, it doesn't mean the proverbial pinch of anything, because until you can prove that there is commodity, like we've proved three times we have a cash instrument to purchase, then see you later. So he then nominated, for the first time again, a trust officer in a Filipino bank that was governmentally organized. And that person was Joven Pulido, and he was the executive vice president of the land bank in Makati. That to me was interesting, because prior to that, it was very difficult to find a trust officer who would execute and therefore put at risk the charter of a bank on proving the availability and authenticity of the commodity that was subject to the contracts.
So did you meet with Mr. Pulido?
Yes.
And did he express a willingness to play that role?
Yes, he did. And he did express that by signing the contracts.
Did you ever see any gold?
I did.
How did you arrange to see the gold?
I didn't do the arranging. It was more a threat, because Mr. Pulido said we do not proceed unless we have the authenticity of product available, because I have the authenticity of the cash instrument. And I said to Mr. Kailau, I'd be advising my parties to disappear if in fact there could be no proof. And between the signing of those contracts with Kailau and final signatures to other unit syndication type arrangements, one evening I received a call, and I was taken in a jeepney. All very strange, I must confess.
Let me interrupt you. Did the person who called you on the phone identify himself or herself?
Yes, Ben Kailau.
Ben Kailau called you?
Called me and said that there would be some proof of his reality. I was to be at the porte cochere of the Holiday Inn at 6:15 one evening, and I would be approached and duly taken to the living proof.
Did you go to the porte cochere of the Holiday Inn and
yes,
something
sir.
Happened?
Yes, I did. I was approached by two gentlemen, both very unlikely, dressed like about 80% of every Filipino you'd see in Manila, and they invited me to sit in the rear of a jeepney, which was less colorful than normal. They're quite attractive devices, but it had tarps on the rear which were closed, and there was a single person driving who looked a little smarter than the average bear.
Did you, was there anyone else who accompanied you, or was it just the driver and yourself?
No, there's a driver and two gentlemen in the rear.
And where did you sit?
I sat on the right-hand side with one gentleman close to the rear, and the other guy was opposite to me in the rear of the vehicle.
Where did they take you?
I don't know.
why don't you know?
Well, I don't know, because I got inside the jeepney and the tarp was closed. I must say it was a very bad night. It was there was a storm coming in across the bay, and the porte cochere, if you know it, at the Holiday Inn is slightly open. So it was damp and it was windy, but we were in that vehicle. We got into the vehicle and we drove. Now, I said, we're going around in bloody circles here. We turned left, we turned left, we turned right, we turned right. By my reckoning, that said we were back onto Rojas Boulevard and going up towards the Manila Hotel. But that wasn't the end of it, because we started turning right and left, and I gave up in the end. I just could not cope with the geographics of where we were at.
Well, why didn't you see where you were going?
Because I was inside a covered element with the tarp closed. And we did that for about, to my estimation, 30 to 40 minutes. And eventually, we arrived at a place. I was asked to put a blindfold across my head. It was given to me. It was just a kerchief type thing. I said, what the hell is this for? And they said, well, we don't want you to see where you are. And the jeepney stopped and a gate was opened. the jeepney started forward and stopped. A gate was closed, at which point in time I was taken out of the rear of the jeepney and I was taken through another gate, which was obviously guarded by at least one person and someone with a dog, or perhaps just a dog that talked. We went through a sort of chain link arrangement. I could hear the clanking and so on. And when they removed the eye cover, I was inside what looked to me like what we call at home a mini storage shed, but it's like a warehouse that was unlined, it was corrugated tin, it was high, it was dusty, nothing flash, nothing pretentious. There was a guard in the far corner, and all I could see was the sort of occasional glint of the eye, and I knew that he was uniformed, I knew that he had a sidearm, and there on the ground were rows of what looked to me like old apple boxes. The timber was not new, it was a weathered timber, and I was invited to open any one or more of those to check the content.
Did you do that?
Yes, I did.
Mm-hmm. What did you do?
I went along and tried to lift a few things, first of all, to see if it all, you know, the same sort of game, and I couldn't budge it because it was quite heavy. The boxes were roughly larger than what you sell here, the Foster's six-pack I saw in a supermarket, about this wide, about this high, and about this long. Not large at all, not as big as a... about, as I say, that long.
I'm not sure that long shows on our videotape. Let me see if we can reduce
maybe
it.
That long would be the length of a foolscap sheet.
All right, well, why don't we... You mentioned something about a Foster's six-pack for Americans.
Yeah.
We're not very familiar with Foster's.
Well, I bought one at Ralph's the other day.
What is Foster's?
It's a beer. It's just a beer, and there's six, and there's a little handle on it. It's about that wide. But that's the nature of it was, and the only new thing I saw about it was the handle, which was difficult to get in and lift because of the weight. It was very cutting on the hand.
Was the handle made of wood?
No, the handle was just, looked like, to me, newish rope. You know, there's nothing flash about it. And I simply pointed to a thing, and the guy bent down and opened the lid, and I looked inside, and there was what I thought was a bullion bar, a bit like a slab of chocolate, except, of course, a different color. Not shiny, not perfect, simply pitted. Reminded me very much of just a crude smelt job, like I've seen aluminium bars with mini pitted, like an orange peel effect on the top. And there were no markings that I could discern, but I certainly couldn't scrape off what could have been a gilt paint across lead or anything like that. I couldn't do any of that.
Did you try to do that?
Yes, I did, with my little fingernail, and I couldn't get any paint to move there, and that was it. I thought, well, that's okay. For what it's proving, this is okay.
How many of these bars did you find in each box?
Well, I don't know if each box had the same number of bars, but in the box that I opened, there appeared to be three.
Were they all substantially the same size?
They looked to be all the same size, yes.
And same shape?
Yes.
Were there any hallmarks or identifying marks on any of these bars?
I'll be perfectly honest, I didn't lift one out and look and check for hallmarks. There's nothing visible on the top, which is where you probably would find a hallmark in the first instance.
Now, how many boxes were opened at your request?
I only opened one because it was a totally random situation. And that, as far as I was concerned, was fine, because they couldn't have known which one I would specify. And I did take my time in ambling around these rows of things.
And how many boxes did you try to lift?
I tried to lift about five or six.
Were you able to lift any of the five or six?
No.
Approximately how many boxes were in this room?
At my count, there'd be about 300 to 400.
After you finished your inspection, what happened?
They said, okay, stick on this band and let's go.
Did you while you were there get any clues as to where this warehouse might be?
Yes, I have personal views that it was close to an airport, which is interesting because if it was close to an airport, it would have been down Paranaque way, which is close to the domestic airport. I couldn't hear any jets, but I heard what I thought were light aircraft take off and landing. Not immediately close, but close enough to say this is close to an airport.
Did you, after that meeting, have any further contact with Ben Kahlo?
Yes.
And did you discuss the subject of the meeting?
Yes.
And what was discussed between you?
That what he had was real.
Who said that?
Ben Kahlo.
And did you dispute that?
I didn't dispute that because we were still negotiating with Hovind Polito with regards to cash instrumentation and the whole product being authenticated via central banker and or any other letter of instruction that was available.
By this time you were working on two new contracts?
Yes.
The 10th and 11th contract?
Yes.
Now did those contracts, to your knowledge, ever get performed?
Not to my knowledge.
Who were the parties to that, those 10th and 11th contracts?
Just Trade International were the initial signatories, and Ben Kahlo and Joe Salvador were the primary signatories to those contracts, together with myself as Remington's representative. But later, there were annexures to those contracts that identified a higher level of negotiation and responsibility. And the higher level was identified in the bank of at Makati, in the presence of Hovind Polito, as Colonel Pimentel. He was identified as a person responsible for the personal piloting of President Marcos and the First Family with regards to any movements in the Philippines and possibly overseas. And Mrs. Lazo as being the parties directly responsible for the contracts and directly responsible to the President of the Philippines.
Did they put their signatures on these annexes to the contract?
Yes, with Just Trade International, yes.
Now, who was Just Trade International?
That was the trading company used by Kahlo and Salvador to handle the disbursements, particularly of any successful contract. In other words, I suppose it was a management company that.
Were you able to solve whatever problems arose on those contracts so that they could get fulfilled?
We had no problem in terms of cash instrumentation, which had been tabled and verified in the presence of Hovind Polito in the land bank. What we had problems with was with an authentication of commodity and availability of commodity to the level that Mr. Polito was happy to proceed. And delays followed delays followed delays followed delays. And Mr. Polito's advice to us was, until such time as I am satisfied, then the deal cannot proceed. We were told by Kahlo and Salvador that they needed a letter of instruction, which could only be issued from Malacañang.
Malacañang's the headquarters of the president?
That's correct.
Now, by the way, were the Philippines, during the period of time you were there, under martial law?
They were. Because shortly after I arrived, Ninoy Aquino was assassinated. And that caused a great deal of consternation and nervousness amongst just about every group of military and political people around, because, you know, the whole atmos of Marcos was starting to get pressured The New People's Army was starting to make inroads. He wasn't sure about the Young Turks within the army. He wasn't sure about some of his political allies. It was, and so there was martial law.
Let me ask you, did you ultimately give up and decide to leave the Philippines?
No, because I'm a stubborn old chap. I decided that if Mr. Cailo and Salvador and Pimentel and Lasso were playing around with President Marcos's reputation and or money and or commodity, then they seemed to be doing it in a fashion that was oblivious to the well-being and integrity of the president. And so I proceeded to try and gain further access to the president because, I mean, everybody I spoke to about all of this didn't seem to care. So subsequent to that, I met with Victor Natuda, who was described, well, A, he was a commissioner of immigration and deportation, but also a confidential secretary to Marcos.
How did you get to Victor Natuda?
I got to Victor Natuda through a family connection from apparently a successful attorney called Ding Bravo, who was in fact related to an American person called Edwin Hutchins. And they set up that meeting with Natuda.
How many times did you meet with Natuda?
I met with Mr. Natuda once at somewhere called the Imperial Palace, a restaurant specializing in Fukien Chinese food and catering for Korean trade commissions. And when I met Mr. Natuda that night, he was in no condition to remember that we did meet. He'd had a jolly good evening. But he was sufficiently able to string together words and say, I'll see you tomorrow morning at 6:30, which was probably another mistake, because he didn't surface until 7:30, but looking very, very fragile.
And did you, at that time, meet with Mr. Natuda?
Yes, indeed, at his house.
And up to that time, had you had any difficulty leaving the Philippines?
No.
And did you, after a meeting with Mr. Natuda, have any difficulty leaving the Philippines when you decided you wanted to go home?
Yes, yes.
When did that occur?
That occurred some 10 days after I met with Victor Natuda. I must tell you that by then I'd also acquired information that related to the smuggling of commodity and backloading of arms, and I happened to have flight numbers, aircraft registration numbers, cargo manifests, and even the pilot who flew on some 110 missions out of Mindanao. That information, plus the actual physical location of some arms caches in Naga City and north of Manila. I felt that that was quite interesting information that the military might like to have, and I tried that across Natuda.
Was that at the meeting there at his home at 7:30 in the morning?
Yes, I told him about all of that, and mirabile dictu, as they say in Latin, nothing happened. It was like saying, I've got a box of cornflakes, or, you know, no one seemed the slightest piece interested in any of that information, until I announced that since everyone he spoke to in the Philippines didn't care about any of this, whether it was bullion or smuggling or armed insurrection or whatever it may be at whatever level, I was going to go home because it must all just be candy floss. At which point in time, Mr. Natuda issued a hold order on my departure, which said, you cannot leave because what you have is information pertinent to the national security of the Philippines.
And did you ever see that hold order?
Eventually, as they say. Eventually.
Was it signed by Mr. Natuda?
Yes, it was.
And so I take it you were not able to go to home as on the date that you wanted.
No, I couldn't. No.
And after you learned of the hold order, did you take steps to try to get it rescinded?
Yes, I did. That involved our Minister of Foreign Affairs in Australia. It involved Reyes, one of the ministers in the Philippines. It eventually involved, obviously, Mr. Natuda, because our Our consul made his life an absolute misery in that regard. And eventually it was rescinded, it was lifted.
Did you have any further meetings with Mr. Natuda after that?
Yes, I did. I had a meeting with Mr. Natuda virtually the day before I left.
Were there any discussions of the subject of gold or the sale of gold or the transportation of gold that you had with Mr. Natuda?
Yes.
Who was present at that meeting?
Mr. Natuda, Edwin Houchins, and Ding Bravo.
Who was Ding Bravo?
He was Houchins' brother-in-law and the attorney that I mentioned previously as being the person who arranged the meeting with Natuda in the first instance.
And what was the subject matter of the meeting?
The subject matter was, Mr. Natuda, thanks for keeping this man here for this period of time. You will be handsomely rewarded for your efforts. And by the way, can you please put in a kind word for Bravo and Houchins so that we can continue with any further bullion dealings for the President of the Philippines?
Who made that statement?
Houchins and Bravo. And the fact that Victor Natuda was there suggested that they already had some sort of commission structure in place.
What was Mr. Natuda's response to the discussion of being involved in any further gold deal?
He seemed to be quite pleased to have done what he did, but at that point I left because at that point in time, as they say, the waters seemed to have parted. Some of the death threats that I received obviously could have been coming then from Houchins and Bravo. The intentions of Houchins seemed now to be very clear that he was interested during all of this in nothing more than establishing the contact network that I had and taking advantage of that for his own purposes.
Okay, but what did Natuda say when it talked about him being involved in further gold?
He seemed to be most gratified.
Do you recall specifically how he indicated this gratification? What did he say? What did he do?
I'll do what I can.
I'd like to show you some photographs that I have marked Plaintiff's Exhibit 1 through 4 and ask you if you can recognize any of the people that are in these photographs. First of all, I'll show you Exhibit Number 1.
Can I look at it for just a second?
Sure.
This way? Check. All right.
Let me show you Exhibit Number 1 now. Can you recognize any of the people that are depicted in that photograph?
I see General Fabian Bear, and I see what I recognize as a younger Victor Natuda in the right foreground.
Where is he? You say right foreground, and I don't have a copy of the picture, so I can look at it. But
right foreground.
All right. Would you be good enough just to hold that up in front of the camera so that the jury will be able to see which one you're looking at and point to Victor Natuda for us?
Right foreground.
Let me show you Exhibit Number 2. And
can I say that I recognize him even without his toupee?
Okay.
Which he was wearing on the morning that I met him in the middle of it.
Exhibit Number 2 I've now placed before you. Do you recognize any of the people?
Yes. That's Natuda again.
Would you hold that up to the camera so and point to Mr. Natuda?
Mm-hmm.
He's the person on the photographer's left, and he is the person on the right as they're standing there.
Mm-hmm.
All right, sir. Let me show you Exhibit Number 3. Do you recognize any of the people in photograph number 3?
Victor Natuda.
All right, you're indicating the second person from the left on the photograph as being Victor Natuda. Is that correct?
Yes.
And the last photograph, Exhibit 4, do you recognize any of the people in Exhibit 4?
Well, apart from President Marcos, I don't know the gentleman in the middle, but I do know that that is Victor Matuda.
On the far right side?
Yes.
Of the meeting on the left side of the photograph?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Taken some time ago.
Now, I have some other documents to mark. Maybe we should take a very short break and I can get them marked, get copies to counsel, and they could look them over before I start interrogating the witnesses. Would that be satisfactory?
That's fine.
We're going off the record at approximately 11. Back on the record at approximately 11:40 a.m.
During the recess, I marked some documents, and I'd like now to direct your attention to them. I have them in front of you. Exhibit number 5, would you pick that up? What is Exhibit 5?
It's a contract organized by John Doe and lodged with Denton, Hall and Bergen in Hong Kong for 4,010 metric tons of bullion.
At the top of that is the word or transaction number. What is, since I can't see it, what does it say at the top there?
Transaction number is 0214 that comes from Clemente's coding requirements. Remington is the company that we were working through, and 4010 refers to the actual number of metric tons offered in the contract.
How does that codification work?
4,000 is the subsequent amount post the receipt of 10 metric tons initially.
So the 10 in 4,010 is for the initial transfer of 10 metric tons, and
yes,
then if that goes through, then 4,000 metric tons.
An option is to take them up in mutually agreed tranches.
Are there any signatures on that document?
Oh, yes.
And do you recognize the signatures there?
Yes, the signature on the front is that of John Edward Dole, my associate. And the witness is William Senner, S-E-N-E-R. It looks like Sibba, but it's Senner, S-E-N-E-R. An American citizen living in the Philippines and an associate of Harold Elkins.
And is there a date as to when that contract was executed?
The execution of the contract was different to the signature or date on the front. Just checking through, I'm sorry, I just... The May 28th was when the contract was signed, but the actual authentication of the contract as being a certified true copy was July 9th. 1983. 83 years.
In this contract, is the seller specifically identified?
The seller is specifically identified. The seller is identified in two places, A, by signature on the page that says signed for in the presence of by the seller, and that is Domingo Clemente.
And is the owner of this gold that's being sold specifically identified?
No, he's not identified in the contract, and probably never would be because of the very nature of the exercise. That's why they have brokers. That's why everyone has brokers. And Domingo Clemente had already specified he was the agent for the Code One, the First Family, and the President.
Let me then direct you to Exhibit Number 6. Is that a similar contract?
Yes.
And how is it identified at the top?
It's identified as 0214, which is a Clemente contract. Remington, again, is our company. And 1560, it relates the a volume of metric tons that would be taken across a two-year period in what they call a supply contract format.
What is
how do we translate 1560 into metric tons of gold?
Well, 1560 actually describes thousands and hundreds of metric tons.
Right. The 60 being 60 metric tons?
60 metric tons, yes.
And then what does the 15 mean?
15,000 subsequent to that.
15,000 or 1,500?
15,000.
Now, are there any signatures on that document?
Yes, this identical signatures in terms of certification of originality, William Senno and John Dole on July 9, 83. The contract similarly signed by Clemente on page three of the document that I have. He's also identified as a beneficiary in one of the annexures, Annexure B, which specifies receipt of benefits from this 1% of commodity value as agent 5 on page 6 thereabouts.
So there was a provision made for Mr. Clemente to make some money on this transaction?
Yes, indeed.
What is Annexure 5?
Annexure B lists those people to receive monies as beneficiaries in the contract, and it specifies the amount of money that they'd receive and where they would receive it.
And are those identifications in code, or are the people or companies named therein?
People are named either by name, by company, or they offer an account. For example, agent number 1, as to 25%, is account number 00822/127. That's Credit Suisse American Bank Antigua, Sand Bank. That account belongs to Josephine. I know that because of dealings with Josephine. The rest are equally clear. Bistray is our company. Remington is our company. Clemente is identified by name. And the other Filipina beneficiaries also are identified by name, all of them using what they call the owner's bank in Hong Kong. And that bank would have been, of course, the bank identified as seller's bank in the front end of the contract as the Hang Lung Bank in Hong Kong.
It is. Is there an Exhibit 6A attached to that, or is it?
Yes.
And what is Exhibit 6A?
Exhibit 6A, if you look at that, is a telex, and it's a telex that has two things which relate to the dialogue and nature of dialogue that I had with Mr. Dole on a daily basis. That has the Hilton Hotel's number in Manila, and it has our answer back in Australia, 44540 Class O, which is DM Clark Surface Paradise. And this reflects the content of the contract and the nature of coding that was offered to us by our buyers. For those who wish to know, I don't know if you do wish to know, but on the one hand, the sellers can't operate without knowing the buyer's code, and on the other hand, the buyers can't operate without knowing the seller's code. So my job was to provide the seller with the buyer's code and the buyer with the seller's code. So that's why I was operating out of there with telex.
And does Exhibit 6A, the telex, relate to what ultimately became Exhibit 6?
Yes, indeed. Yes.
Let's go to Exhibit 7 then, please. Is that another similar contract?
Yes.
And what does it say at the top?
4010D.
And we already had a 4010, I believe.
That's correct. Same volume, different buyer.
So therefore a different contract.
Yes.
Same amount of gold as was the subject of Exhibit 5, which is 4010?
Yes, indeed.
Signatories the same?
Yes.
Excuse me just a moment. Which one of these two did you mark as 6A? They look roughly the same, except for some handwritten marks.
Telex, that's all.
Here, you can just
choose it.
Handwritten stuff on it. Okay, that's all.
I think they might be. Excuse me. I was just going to look at whether or not the telex was double. In other words, one with a comment and one without. Yes. You'll see that there's been a modification to the telex.
So the six, telex. 6A is two different telexes?
It's the same telex, but with modification, which was then integrated into contract.
Okay. All right, let's see. We were on Exhibit 7, if I remember, and that was 4010D?
Yes.
Once again, would you tell us how much gold was the subject of that contract?
Initially, the receipt of 10 metric tons, which proved the authenticity of the transaction. Thereafter, 4,000 metric tons to be taken in mutually agreed drops, so that the final volume would be 4,010 metric tons.
Were the signatories to that agreement the same as on the prior exhibits?
Yes, they are. The witnesses now include David Sayok. They are the same.
Do these contracts that we've covered so far mention a specific price for the gold medal?
All 4% below.
Below the, what?
The second fix, second LME exchange rate.
LME mean London Medical Metal.
Yes.
London Metal
Exchange rate, yes, and it's the second fixing of the previous Friday to the delivery. In other words, as the price of gold moves, whatever that price of gold may be, then the price that will pertain in the contract would be 4% below that which was specified on the Friday prior to the delivery of the product.
And during the time specified for the delivery, approximately what was gold trading for on the London Metal Exchange per ounce?
At the time, it was moving between $416 to $422 an ounce.
All right, sir, let's move on to exhibit number 8 then, and would you identify 8 for us?
Another Remington contract, initially 60 metric tons, followed by 15,000. Across a two-year period.
The signatories, are they the same?
Yes.
Excuse me, can you say what the designation is, the code on the top?
Yes.
1560A. The 1560 refers to the actual volumes, and it's explained in A3, General Terms and Conditions of Sale, which is 60 metric tons, subsequently followed by 15,000 metric tons across a two-year period. And the A simply refers to that volume to another buyer. So in other words, 1560 would be the initial contract, and if there was an alphabetic addition to that, A, B, C, D, E, and so on, to that volume, it would be same volume but different buyers, identical contracts.
So these 9 Remington contracts deal with different amounts, I don't mean amounts, but different gold.
Yes.
So we don't have the same amount of gold being sold 9 different times, but we have 9 different amounts of gold.
On the representations of the seller and their capacity, this is what they are suggesting, that in fact they are selling not the same gold 9 times, but 9 different parcels.
So if we wanted to know the total amount of gold subject to the transaction, we would add up the amount of gold involved in each of the 9 contracts.
That is correct.
All right, let's move on then. Exhibit 9, I believe, is the next one.
Yes, 1560D.
And is that a similar contract?
Yes, it is. Yes.
Same signatories?
Yes.
And anything different or unusual about that contract as distinguished from the others?
Only the buyer, which we see in Annexure A, A2, buyer's bank details.
And what amount of gold is the subject of Exhibit 9?
Exhibit 9 is 1,560 metric tons, as with 1560A and 1560, same amount.
All right.
Same condition.
Let's go to Exhibit 10. How is that contract identified?
Identified as 1560F, same signatories, same witnesses to the authenticity of the contract, Domingo Clemente is the seller's representative authorized. Terms and conditions identical to others. And the difference in this contract exists in A2, which is the buyer's bank details, identified with different codes, Centera Merchant Bank, on page 4 of the contract.
All right, let's, unless there's something remarkable about Exhibit 10, we identify 11 for us, please.
A similar amount of bullion, specified as G, simply indicating, again, a different buyer. Reflected in A2, Annexure A, page 4. So G is same volume, different buyer.
All right, let me direct your attention to Exhibit 12.
Exhibit 12 is the same as the previous contract 4010, except again we have a different buyer. 4010, as A3 reflects, is 10 metric tons initially, with 4,000 metric tons to be taken up in mutually agreed tranches across a timeline to be agreed between buyer and seller. A reflects a different buyer. The different buyer is reflected in page 4, Annexure A, A2, buyer's bank details.
Now, if I've counted correctly, we've gone through 8 Remington contracts, and you told us previously there were 9. Have we been able, in the recess, to find the 9th contract?
Not to my knowledge.
And how is the 9th contract identified?
The 9th contract is 0214-Remington-LC1M. The coding for that I know quite clearly because I allocated the coding to it. LC1M refers to a letter of credit that was offered to us to purchase bullion for $1 million. It was offered by an American company.
And are we able, or are you able to tell us how much gold was the subject of that 9th contract?
Not a great deal, because it was $1 million only.
So it was $1 million worth of gold, or up to $1 million?
It was up to $1 million worth of gold to be purchased initially on that revolving letter of credit, and then amounts subsequently they were able to raise and acquire. That was the terms and conditions of their contract.
Was the seller in each of these 9 contracts the same?
The sellers in each of these contracts was identical.
Who, if you know, drafted these contracts? Who prepared them? Some lawyer?
They were prepared initially by the seller's agents. They were rejected by our buyers and by ourselves because of the impossibility of meeting the absolutes of their requirements in financial terms. As I said earlier, an absolute irrevocable letter of credit without any proof of stock is no way to get a buyer to go into a bank. Therefore, it had to be changed. It was changed on advice that we took from bankers and accountants in Australia, and it was taken across the original framework that was offered to us by the sellers. So I suppose it was a collaborative modification to the original contracts offered by the sellers' representatives.
Now I've placed before you exhibit number 13. Can you tell us what that document is?
This is simply a document that John Bell, my associate, placed in the hands of solicitors in Hong Kong detailing what they'd be managing on our behalf by the company structures established in Hong Kong, in the Bahamas, but of course bouncing out of Hong Kong. They would have been administering the companies of Bistray and Groin.
And what was done with that document?
This document was lodged with Mr. Grant in Hong Kong to notify him of the specifics of the contracts. He also received a copy of each contract, and that was detailed, if I'm not mistaken, in this document here.
Which you're indicating Exhibit 14?
Yes.
I was going to ask you next, what is Exhibit 14?
Exhibit 14 is the document that John Bell wrote to John Grant. He had to write it because he didn't have his office with him in Hong Kong. And the reason that I was attracted to that is because Mr. Dale's writing is very distinctive, and I got to know it quite well across 3 years.
And what generally was the purpose of the letter?
To advise him of several things. To advise him, Grant and Denton Hall and Bergen, of A, the nature, and B, the specifics of what we were doing, and to identify the actual coding and purchases on each contract. And on this particular document, you'll see that they're all listed. Mitsubishi has got two buyers on two contracts, 1560D and 4010D. Heritage is the same thing on 1560 and 4010. And we've got similar buyers on 1560A and 410A, different buyers on 1560F, G, and the LC.
Incidentally, you mentioned Heritage Bank. Where was it located at the time?
The address that we had was Wilshire Boulevard.
For Heritage or Mitsubishi?
Mitsubishi.
I mentioned Heritage. Mm.
Heritage, I think, was affiliated very heavily with Salt Lake City, as I understand it.
All right. Have we now gone through all of the Remington contracts and the documents that were prepared and given to Mr. Tony Grant in Hong Kong?
Yes, we have. Apart from the LC1M that we couldn't find. I know it exists because I did code it myself.
All right, let's move on to then Exhibit 15. Can you tell me what 15 is?
15 is the contract that was derived by Ben Kailau, in his words, as a means of actually making good the failure of contracts that Clemente and Laurel interrupted. The failure, not in terms of moving the bullion, but the failure in terms of us receiving brokerage across the amount of bullion moved. This particular exhibit relates to 225 metric tons or thereabouts at a very specific local purchase per peso, per gram weight.
Is this the contract that you talked about earlier where Mr. Kailau pointed out to you that this would make good the commission that you didn't get paid in one of the earlier Remington contracts?
Correct.
And did Mr. Kailau indicate to you on whose instructions he was working as it related to seeing that you got your commissions?
He said that he'd been sent directly from Malacañang by the president. He said he was operating on behalf of the president and that there was no risk whatsoever to A, my safety, which was another point of contention, and B, the validity of the transaction.
The what of the transaction?
The validity of the transaction. This was straight from the horse's mouth, so to speak.
All right. Now, I noticed that that document has several pages. Are there any dates on there as to when that contract was entered into?
Yes, this was signed on the 14th day of October, and there were various amendments and appendices that Mr. Kailau and others wanted to get into that related to deed of transfer of gold ownership. A warranty of funds availability, the standard thing, which was to make sure that the whole business was kosher, and copies furnished for that purpose to people like Hovind Polito, Assistant Vice President of the Land Bank, and other banks in Hong Kong.
Who were the signatories to the contract itself?
Myself, Kailau, and Salvador. Salvador being the president and Kailau being the vice president of that company, so-called Just Trade. But of significance is another document to be signed in the event of the release of that, signed by the principal owner and possessor, and that document has not been, in fact, signed. It was to be lodged, of course, with the bank, and the bank would have handled in confidence that transaction.
And the actual owner of the gold was to sign that?
Yes.
Do you know whether or not that document ever got signed and lodged?
No, I can't say that it would have. It was signed. I am still without the commission from any of the transactions, but I'm not without the statements made and the acts that have occurred that relate to all of this.
Who signed that agreement on behalf of the seller?
Kailao and Salvador.
All right. Let's turn then to Exhibit 16.
Yes.
Can you tell me what Exhibit 16 is?
Exhibit 16 is another contract.
Between whom?
Between Just Trade International. And it's offering further stocks.
Stocks of what?
Bullion.
And is it dated?
Yes, it's dated the 27th day of October, 1983.
And was it signed?
It was signed by Kailao, Salvador, and myself, and it was witnessed by Joven Polido of the land bank in Makati.
Who signed it on behalf of the seller?
Kailao and Salvador. But there's an annexure to this particular contract coming through, because at this point in time we started to hit impediments. And the real impediment was that Kailao and Salvador, although the initial securers of genuine purchases, in fact were the second layer to the actual owner's representation. And those people coming forward after this were Colonel Pimentel and Mrs. Lazo across the same materials.
And they were the first layer then?
Kailao and Salvador were the first layer.
Working backwards towards the owner, were they the first layer from the owner or the first layer going back?
Oh, I see. Working from the owner, then the first layer was Pimentel and Lazo, and the second layer was Kailao and Salvador.
Pimentel is the person that you'd previously identified as the personal pilot of the president and first family?
In the presidential command, yes.
And how much gold is the subject of Exhibit 16?
5,000 metric tons, moving forward until some 25,000 tons of commitments.
Now the last exhibit is Exhibit 17. Will you tell us what that is?
This is the client-seller relationship and various bits and pieces about a revocable unisyndication and memoranda of agreement. And that is to say, this is us agreeing not to allow Pimentel and Lazo to shaft Salvador and Kailao for the work that they've done. I think it's called a document of trust or mistrust that these people wanted to make sure that they were not circumvented by Pimentel and Lazo now that they in fact made them available, and therefore what we had was various statements of and signatures from beneficiaries that says, you know, we will make sure that the conditions of the contact would be fully implemented as sellers' representatives.
Did Pimentel and or Lazo indicate whom they were representing?
They did, and Kailao and Salvador did, in the presence of Joven Polido again.
What representations did they make?
The representation I made was that this was a matter that they were attending to on behalf of the President of the Philippines.
Mr. O'Brien, when was the first time you visited with Mr. Cathcart or a representative of his office about this matter?
I called in to see Mr. Cathcart on mid-morning Monday of this week.
I'm asking about the very first time you had any contact with Mr. Cathcart or a representative of his firm regarding this topic that you've been testifying to in the deposition?
I had an inquiry in May of this year, which was an inquiry suggesting that I may or may not have material pertinent to something that Mr. Cathcart was proceeding with. The extent of that material's value to it, I had no idea about, and of course neither did they, because of the nature of the exercise.
Are you talking in May of 1992?
Yeah, oh, yes, yes.
And in that initial contact in May of 1992, did you discuss with Mr. Cathcart much of what you discussed here in your deposition today?
No, not at all.
Okay. When did you discuss with Mr. Cathcart or a representative of his office much of the substance of what you revealed in your deposition today?
Mainly today in terms of questions, because the nature of materials and the questions based on those materials have come out of the fact that he's got the documents, which he didn't have before. I had the documents, so I didn't know what questions or what value that would have.
Did you send Mr. Cathcart these documents that had been marked as exhibits to your deposition?
Yes, I did.
And when did you do that?
I sent those in, as I remember, in July, August, I think. But I sent them voluntarily because I wasn't aware of their impact, if at all, on what was being investigated.
Prior to today, did you discuss with Mr. Cathcart the substance of these transactions?
Only in the broadest terms.
What conversations do you recall having with Mr. Cathcart prior to today regarding the substance of these transactions?
Are they the contracts that were sent? Can you please put them in an order that would help myself and others to examine them? And that's really the extent of the discussion that, if you can call that discussion with regards to content. And did it really happen was the other question, to which I said yes.
Are we talking more than one conversation?
We're talking about the conversation we had on Monday.
Okay. Mm. And prior to Monday, had you discussed with Mr. Cathcart or a representative of his office the substance of these transactions?
I had not spoken with Mr. Cathcart, but I had spoken in general terms with one of Mr. Cathcart's representatives. But I must say, it was highly generalized because they didn't know what I knew and what I had.
Do you recall with whom you spoke?
Yes, I do, with Arlene Friedman.
And do you recall when that conversation took place?
It took place I would have to check my diary to be specific. I don't want to get caught in a technicality of time or chronology. But it was during the period August, September.
Okay.
Yeah.
The contracts which you've identified as exhibits 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. Were you present during the execution of any of those contracts?
No, I wasn't present during the execution of the contracts, but I was present as I described with regard to the machining together of those, because those contracts could not have occurred without my involvement. I refer you simply to one of the telexes.
Where were you when the contracts were executed?
I was in Surfers Paradise on the Gold Coast in Australia, and that was the sort of communications link between the buyer's bank and the seller's representatives. In other words, the contracts could not have been designed and coded unless I had been involved, because I supplied the seller's representatives with the buyer's codes, and vice versa.
You mentioned that you met Mr. Tony Dacus while you were in
yes.
the Philippines.
Yes, I did.
What was your understanding of his involvement in the transaction?
He was very much, as I said, looking to the interests of Mr. Joseph Bin. I understood that they were associates. I didn't ask for evidence of that association, but he seemed to have an intimate knowledge of Mr. Zabin's activities, the timelines and the nature of our business. It came out of the blue. The first call was from Angeles City, and I subsequently met with Mr. Dacus on two occasions in Manila itself.
Did Mr. Dacus tell you how he became associated with Mr. Zabin?
No, we didn't discuss the beginnings of their association at all. He was very much concerned about the failure of the contracts to deliver the promised financial benefits to Mr. Zabin, particularly Sandbank account in Antigua.
Did Mr. Dacus describe to you what his particular role in the transaction was?
He described himself as an associate of Mr. Joseph Dinn.
Other than that, did he describe to you what his function was in this in these transactions?
To make sure that the end result was beneficial. That was his role in Manila.
Did you develop the opinion that he was acting sort of as a bodyguard for Mr. Zabin?
Well, Mr. Zabin wasn't there, so there was no body to guard. But he did actually give the impression that he was supportive of Mr. Zabin's interests. And looking at his size, I believe it would be quite easy to extend the bodyguard physically into what he could do, yes. He looked like an all-in wrestler to me.
Did Mr. Dacus tell you what his compensation or fee would be for his participation in these transactions?
No, he didn't. He just said he had a lot coming out of it, and he urged me to expedite the matter quite forcibly.
Were any of your travel expenses paid for by representatives of the plaintiff in this lawsuit to come to the United States to give this testimony?
No. I'll make it clear, I've got an 82-year-old mother. I'm in the process of retiring from the Queensland Department of Education, and I already scheduled a visit to Europe, and the deviation economically and geographically for me via the States is not a problem, but it already had been scheduled.
Have you been offered or paid any sort of compensation for your assistance in providing these documents or information to the plaintiffs?
Not at all. All of the documentation that's in the hands of Magana Cathcart and McCarthy is freely given at no charge, so to speak.
I don't have any other questions.